There's fantastic news on the vaccine front, and we've heard that we've got the first vaccine through the regulations. Regulators have promised that there are no corners that have been cut with the new COVID-19 vaccines. And that's looking at safety data, and that is looking at efficacy data, so how well the vaccines work. But a quite big question I'm trying to understand is how closely vaccination is going to mimic infection. My name is Professor Alex Richter, and I'm Director of the Clinical Immunology Service at the University of Birmingham. And I've been focusing on COVID research, and in particularly the immunity of COVID over the last 9 months. What I'm interested in at the moment is understanding those differences between natural infection and vaccination. And to understand those differences, I need to know a little bit about how the vaccines work. It's important to know which vaccines are available to us or will be available to us. And to start to put this together and to answer some key questions like, is everybody going to respond to vaccination? I look after patients who have immune deficiencies, and I don't know how well they are going to respond to vaccination, because the studies have been done in usually healthy individuals, and understanding how the vaccine is going to work in someone that is on, say, a chemotherapy drug or on a rheumatoid arthritis drug or has an immune deficiency for another reason is just not known yet. And this is why we need to really closely monitor the implementation of vaccines. And we call that post-marketing surveillance. Now, there are a few ways that we do that. We can look at the different parts of the immune system. So when I'm thinking about long-lived immunity to an infection, I'm thinking about the memory response that the immune system produces, because it's that memory response which stops you being infected again. Now, the vaccines are against a very specific part of the virus called the spike. Now, that spike is really important because that is how a virus, and the COVID-19 virus, gets into a cell. And for a virus to reproduce, it has to get into a cell. So if you can block that virus entering a human cell, you can block infection. So most of the vaccines to date have targeted this spike. And so what we want to be able to do is detect that a vaccine can produce spike antibodies. So we need a specific type of vaccine test, which detects the spike. And not all of the antibody tests out there at the moment are against the spike. Some are against other parts of the COVID-19 virus. So we'll monitor antibody responses. And it's important not just to monitor the response to the vaccine initially, but monitor what happens to that response. Now, I've been monitoring antibodies against COVID for the last 6-7 months now, and I can see that for most people, they hold on to their antibodies for really quite a long period of time. There's a few people that drop off, but that's kind of normal. Most people are holding on to their antibodies. There is always going to be some people that are going to get repeat infections, and a lot of these individuals are in my clinics, and some, this may be because of immune deficiency, but some might just be that they haven't produced an immune response for whatever reason to the first infection. So we need to look not just at the antibodies after the vaccine, but the longevity of that vaccine response. For a vaccine to be useful, it'd be brilliant if you could vaccinate someone once and then that's it for life. But the reality we know is that for most vaccines, you need to repeat the dose and give it a bit of a boost. Now, some of the reason for that is the differences between natural immunity and infection. Think about when you have an infection. Think about when you have a viral infection. You feel really achy, feverish, not very well. Now, the reason you feel like that is because your immune system is producing lots of inflammatory markers to try and combat that early viral infection. And the side effect of trying to kill virus is it makes you not feel very good. Now, the other thing that all those inflammatory markers do is that they highlight to the immune system that whatever this foreign protein is in the body, i.e. the virus, that it's bad. So it's almost like danger signals. So the difference with a vaccine is that you're giving someone the vaccine when they're entirely well. And you're expecting that immune response to recognize that protein as foreign and produce as strong an immune response as natural infection. So it doesn't always happen. And sometimes you need to boost how strong that response is by giving a second vaccine or what we call using adjuvants. But none of the key vaccines to date are adjuvanted. What's been really exciting about the COVID-19 vaccines is that we've utilized some brand new technologies. Usually what we do for vaccination is we give somebody a dead part of the infection. So a dead part of the virus or even just a few proteins from that virus to produce an immune response. But for a couple of the technologies that we're using for the main vaccines that are coming to market first, we're using brand new technologies, something called mRNA vaccines. So you're giving a little bit of the messenger information to a cell to produce this spike protein. So really exciting that we've actually, through COVID-19, advanced the whole field of vaccinology. The other story you may have heard about is the chimpanzee vaccine. And again, this is a really clever, neat idea. I mean, what they've done is used a common virus that gives us the cold most years. And they've isolated this virus, just so happens, from chimpanzees. And they then use that virus to introduce a little bit of the spike vaccine, the spike protein to the body. That adenovirus then dies within one cycle. So all you're left with is a little bit of the spike protein, which the body can produce an immune response to. So I know some people have been worried that maybe the adenovirus will keep reproducing and might cause illness in patients that can't mount an immune response. But that's not the way the vaccine's designed. And we're giving the advice that it's safe to give to all our immune deficiency patients. So we're looking to see how long the vaccines last for, and we're looking to see whether everybody makes the same type of immune response. Now, I've talked quite a bit about antibodies and the antibody response, but there are other parts of the immune system that we need to think about as well. So we know that antibodies wane, and sometimes they wane to indetectable. But that doesn't mean that an individual is necessarily not protected, because the cell that produces the antibody is a long-lived memory cell. And that long-lived memory B cell can be hiding in the bone marrow or hiding in the tissues and can be rapidly reactivated to produce more antibodies if an individual is exposed to infection again. So just because you don't have antibodies doesn't mean that you're definitely going to get an infection if you're exposed again. And the other really important part of the immune system that we haven't talked about is T cells. And T cells are like the conductors of the orchestra, the conductors of the immune system. And they are able to recognize and activate the immune system and teach the body to produce more antibodies very rapidly, and are actually able to clear cells with the virus very, very rapidly as well. Now, it's more difficult to test for T cell responses. It's a much more complicated laboratory test, and so usually it's reserved for research settings. But all the researchers and the studies from the vaccine trials have shown that the vaccines to date produce not only good antibodies, but good T cell responses. And we will be continuing to look to see that individuals, especially individuals who might be at risk of not responding to the vaccination, are still able to produce T, B and antibody responses. So we've made huge progress over the last 9 months. Think Christmas last year, we hardly even knew what this virus was. In this time, we've produced tests against the virus. We've done huge studies looking at how the virus spreads and who is most at risk of this. We're trying to investigate now why certain individuals and certain groups of individuals are more at risk than others. And then also we've produced a vaccine, and a process that usually takes at least 10 years has been achieved quite remarkably in less than a year. And I know that the vaccine is starting to be shipped. Now we've got the approvals and appointments are already being made to the first groups that are going to be vaccinated, which include our healthcare workers. And I'm very much looking forward to my appointment letter where I will be signed up for whichever vaccine is going to be coming into our hospital. And then I'm also signing up for the surveillance studies to be able to monitor what is happening to the vaccine response, because that will hopefully help understand what we should be doing with vaccines every year. So it might be that we need to be having a booster every autumn, like we do with the flu vaccine.